Are we ready for our first guest?
I think we are. I think we're good.
Are you guys ready for the first guest? You guys ready to eat Pocahontas? Yeah, that's right.
I like you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Irene Bedard.
Hello. How are you? Where should I sit?
You can sit right here.
All right. Good evening.
How does she do it better than me? She knew. This is that actress training right there.
So hello, Irene.
Hello.
How are you liking Miami so far?
Love Miami. The rain, you know, tomorrow's supposed to not rain, so yay. Yay. I was going to go to the beach, but, you know, maybe not today. Tomorrow, right? Let's go tomorrow.
Yeah, there was tornado warnings today.
There were.
Very dangerous, very exciting.
Supercon tonight presents the weather. Okay.
And then tomorrow
we're going to come back with stock reports in just a minute.
How to make your whites wider.
It's raining hard, though.
Yes, it is. It is. We had to run extra.
I'm from Alaska, though, so, like, you know, rain, snow, whatever.
That's right. You were born in Anchorage, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anchorage, you were born in Anchorage.
I got an Anchorage fan over here. He said, yeah.
Anchorage.
So that's where all the, like, Anchorage is where, I believe, for 6 months, it's a really good glow-in-the-dark sales, right? Is that true?
Where's Bill Nye? Okay, so, you know, the planet's like this, right? And then there's the sun. And then, you know, we have waning and waxing. You know, it gets shorter days and longer days. Well, the Arctic circle that we put on the globe when you have it in your house, that's where there's about 30 days of darkness. Or when the planet's tilted this way, 30 days of light. So Anchorage is down below the Arctic Circle, but Alaska is not that small in the little box over there. It's can span almost across America. So Anchorage is down pretty far below, but we do have shorter winters than Ohio, say, you know. I mean, shorter nights, so, yeah. But no, we do have a little more snow sometimes, except, you know, now we've got polar bears that are, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I heard polar bears are having a tough time.
They are having a tough time.
They are having a tough time.
Yeah, it's the economy.
Yeah.
I think that's what it's
not climate change.
Oil prices are dropping.
The economy. Yeah, it's rough.
They just can't afford. Fox News tells me. So, yeah. I mean, that's what's.
Yeah. They just can't afford that Coca-Cola anymore. It's rough.
Yeah. Again, Bill Nye, where are you? Years and years ago, I would say, you don't believe in climate change? Talk to an Eskimo. I'm a Inupiaq, and on my mother's side, my dad was stationed up there, and he was French, Canadian, and Cree. But, you know, we're moving villages because the ocean is rising.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And actually, you mentioned talking about Bill Nye being here. You're actually a physics major, right?
I was a physics major, and philosophy major before I went into theater.
There's a slight woo in the background. We said physics major.
Woo! Awesome. I am a science geek! Yay!
But so you're a physics major, but of course, the main reason that everybody here would know you is not so much physics, but obviously you're the voice of Pocahontas.
I am the voice of Pocahontas, yes.
I
think we have a question.
Do we take questions in this show?
Yeah, I mean.
They're Spider-Man. Do we have a question?
I mean, he showed up, so whatever. Whoa.
So Spider-Man doesn't believe me.
The man in the mask is calling for an identity crisis. I see how it is. Voice recognition here.
Yeah.
No, this isn't Disney karaoke. I think that's a panel already.
That's
somewhere
a panel,
else,
yeah,
isn't it?
Actually. That's so. Much later tonight.
Much later, apparently.
Much later.
Into the wee hours.
When everyone's asleep. Oh, God.
You know, You know, I did a Disney. My very first film was a Disney movie, and it was Squanto, A Warrior's Tale. And Squanto was there at the first Thanksgiving, and I've had in my life what I call the manifest destiny characters, you know, that I've had a chance to portray or be a part of the storytelling of the people who, you know, maybe were got into the history books for that very reason. But there I got, on my very first film, I got to work with the Mi'kmaq people. Now, in my state alone, there are 296 tribes. In the all of North America, there are more than 500 tribes here, and I got to work with the Mi'kmaq people, which were Algonquin-based, and so was Pocahontas. And I was given a song by one of the women, one of the Mi'kmaq women, and I sang it in the film, but it didn't work out in editing, and I will sing that one for you. Sa-ju-e Giske salu ne gawon kidelamu weheya 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 wehei. Always I have loved you, always I think of you, always I think of you.
Oh my God.
Kuyana.
I was wow. Yeah. That was wow.
That like warmed my soul.
Yeah, it really is.
That was incredible.
Mm-hmm.
It's about love. I love love.
That was, and you can get that from the song. Like, right. It just sounds so beautiful. Aw.
And that passion has become now, you've started a production company a few years ago with the intention of really putting to the center stage more indigenous actors to make people more aware. Because I know, you know, back in the 1950s, it was kind of they grabbed whatever Arab they could and called them. Because I remember Michael Ansari was a Syrian, and he pretty much was playing almost every Native American role in the 50s there. And so your production company is more about bringing the natives to actually playing natives.
Well, and I think that it goes even further beyond that, which mm-hmm. is there's so many amazing, beautiful stories. There are 400 million indigenous people in this world, and we have so much, I think, to offer, especially, you know, our society as it is right now. I mean, we've missed out on a lot of things like rites of passage or understanding about our environment or you know, having a respect for our elders or even the coming generations, understanding that what you do today affects the next 7 generations, you know, so that we have to be conscious of who we are. And so there's so much positive news from Indian country and Native people around the world, and that's really what it's about.
I'm down. I'm in.
I'm down.
I'm in.
Yeah.
I got like 3 hosts here. I'm in. I'm sorry, guys. I'm touched by this. I really want to, yeah. You spoke to us earlier backstage. You guys are working on, you were talking about one about Colombia recently.
Yeah, we have several books that we have in the works. One's called Two Old Women.
Mm-hmm.
It's based on a international bestseller,
right.
That is the story of two Gwich'in women who are old, and it is why the Gwich'in people do not leave their old people in times of hardship and harsh winters. What I love about it is that it gives the opportunity for our elders and for women to kind of be. They're the ones who saved the people because they knew how to survive during that harsh winter.
Mm-hmm.
And the other film that we have is based on a novel by Luis Castillo, who's okay. Colombian. And it deals with the indigenous people's knowledge of the medicinal. Well, basically it has this treasure of the San Jose, which they just did find recently. This is somewhat based on reality. and it has this amazing treasure in it. They believe that there's tons of gold on it. But beyond that, that in this telling, there's also this book that has all of the knowledge of the indigenous people and the ability to, you know, cure all diseases out of the medicinals that the native people understood, this ancient knowledge. So it is a little bit of a story because it jumps back between the 1600s and modern story and the pharmaceutical industry.
Right.
Oh, that sounds super intriguing.
Yeah, we were talking backstage and we called it the native Da Vinci Code. Right?
I know, and I was like, there's my elevator pitch.
The Pope in the 1600s. The secret to cancer must not be found.
Yes.
Yeah. Any opportunity to sneak your Ricardo Montalban impression, you'll take it.
What?
Any opportunity to sneak your Ricardo Montalban impression, you'll take it.
In the 1600s, I believe he was Italian at that point. Yeah, I'm sorry.
At that point.
History major. All right.
Excuse me.
Going for the cheap joke.
I'm done. All right, I'm done. I've already put this kid to sleep. We're over.
I love Ricardo. I loved him.
Do you have any questions? I feel like we've left you out completely on this.
It's okay.
We'll keep it up.
Definitely
to
that. No, oh, okay. That's cool. That's the story of my life. No, but I'm interested. I'm very into like holistic healing.
Mm-hmm.
So that sounds very interesting.
That sounds.
Is there like is it in production or is there like a book? Is there?
We have these are a couple of the books that we have, but we do have literally. You know, I stopped at 44 because it's 2 fours and that's a magic number. And but we have there's so much left to be told about indigenous people. We have a show called Reservations Not Required, which is a Navajo cordon bleu trained chef who's also a cultural anthropologist. And he goes around indigenous country and worldwide to the Maori and looks at foods, you know, our foods and what is that? You know, what is indigenous food? And I think that the world is kind of coming into that too. You know, I mean, why do we have quinoa? Because, you know, someone realized, wow, that's a superfood. These people know what they're doing.
Right. I've always wondered about the evolution of food. Like, who's looking at an onion like that?
Yeah.
That's going to be chopped up and grilled with butter.
And it's
once
gonna,
I invent
and
butter.
It's going to make it good.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah, I always wonder about, like, the first person who came across a lobster and was like, that looks delicious.
I'm convinced the indigenous Japanese people were the laziest people ever. Because I don't want to cook it. All right, I didn't die. I didn't die. We're good.
You do realize, though, that, like, lobster and shrimp, they're like the arachnids. They're like the spiders of the sea
My
world.
Dad calls them cockroaches
of
the
sea. Yeah, sea cockroaches, they would call it.
Which, when you think about it that way, you don't want to pay market price for them.
But that's the thing. I mean, think of being in the Arctic North and, like, what it would take to survive and what it, you know, to be able to kind of look at your environment and be in it so well that you look at the animals, you look at the plants, and you look at the seasons, and you understand, well, we paved over everything. Mm-hmm. You know, we like walk through the aisles, the well-lit aisles, and go, what is that chicken? No, it's a chicken. It walked. It had eyes. Mm-hmm. It's not, you know, this relationship to our food has to be... I think just more equally understood by us all, you know, so that we can be more thankful and grateful for the fact that this, whether it's spinach or a chicken, had to pass so that we could survive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I respect chicken a lot more now.
Converted like 50% of our audience into vegetarians. But not that guy. Oh, no.
No.
I'm going to go eat chicken right now.
Quick question here, because we're going to be wrapping up soon, though. A Disney question.
Disney question, yeah.
But something that you are not related to, that at least that we don't know. Mm-hmm. Being from the region that you're from and everything, what did you think of the Disney movie Brother Bear? Was that way off key, or was that, you got a couple things right. Excluding the Rick Moranis moose, of course.
No, I just think that, you know, I mean, and I know also that that Pocahontas was only 11 years old when she met John Smith. So it wasn't historically accurate, for sure. But what it did was it created teachers mm-hmm. who then said, you know, hey, that's the wrong story. I think that any form of communication is great, and if it's something that engages our young people, that they then get this light inside of them where they want to grow up and find out more, then it's done its job.
Right.
You know, our imaginations together are a force beyond belief.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it took us all the way up until 1840 to become 1 billion people. And from 1840 to now, we've gone to 7 billion people. We've got to learn how to live together.
Absolutely.
We have to. Yeah. If we don't, then, you know, we're going to really mess up. Mm-hmm. And we're pretty messing up right now, and we just got to get better at it. So that wasn't really a Disney answer, was it?
But I think the other idea is, it promoted cultural awareness, and that was the job that it was supposed to do. People are still going to research it. Mm-hmm. However off base it's going to be, people are going to research it, be like, oh, okay, no, it's more like this. And from that, they'll understand, they'll take from a culture. And eventually, exposure will get people to like each other, mm-hmm. which is why I think they need to reissue Aladdin. So thank you very much, Irene. Irene Bedard, everybody. We have all been cultured.
Boyana.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Hey, there's water.
Oh, yeah.
You have a good night, and hopefully you'll come out for the rest of the weekend.
How you doing, Nick?
I'm doing great, except for the fact that I completely forgot who the next guest is.
That's okay. You can get out your list. We're going to talk to the audience a little bit.
That's fine.
Have a good day, Krysti?
It's been a great day. I got to hang out with Bill Nye, so I feel like, how could you have a bad day?
You can't have a bad day hanging out with Bill Nye.
You can't.
Right.
Yeah, no.
Unless, of course, you work for Fox News.
Then you're having a really bad day. Really
then,
bad day.
Yeah. So. So, you got that list yet?
I know it's. I did. I figured
it out. I think we got
out.
Rigby coming up, don't we? Whoa. This means the crowd's going to leave afterwards now.
Yeah.
That's that signal.
Please.
William, you're last.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, from regular show, you know him as Rigney. Here is William Salyers.
Yeah.
Man, I have to follow beauty, brains, and intellect.
Yeah, Godspeed.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. I mean, I am not a physicist. I got to be in Algebra 1, a C in Algebra 2, and then cut my losses.
Wow, you passed Algebra 1 the first time? Good job, man.
Yeah, hey. So now I feel smart.
Yeah. I legit didn't. William.
What? Yes.
So, William.
Yes.
How are things?
Please call me Bill.
Hi, Bill.
Hi. How are? Yes.
Made a connection.
Call him Rigby.
I'll answer to anything. It's all fine. Right. Rigby, Morden Solis, a bunch of people from Fallout 4. Hello.
Hi.
Trash boat. I changed it back. Oh! I'm feeling the Miami love.
Mm-hmm. Morden Solis by far was one of my favorite characters.
Thank you
series.
So much.
Yeah, I loved it. And of course, I'm a Gilbert and Sullivan fan, so that was just the extra cherry on top for me.
One, I always try to point out to people, just to be straight up, that I did not create that role. That role was created by an actor named Michael Beatty, who played him initially, created the role, and then for some reason, and I don't know why, didn't come back for Mass Effect 3, so I got to do that great death scene. Oh, spoiler alert. that was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. So, Rigby. That's what you're known for. That's what they're here for, apparently.
That's what they're here for, apparently. Spider-Man's very excited.
I think he's going to ask you to sing, Rivwood.
Oh, jeez. All right, I'm okay. Are you okay?
Yeah. We're okay with another question.
Yeah, what's up? What do I think about it?
Do you like the thing that's paying you?
Cha-ching! No, it's just the best job in the world. I love it. I love working on the show. You know, we record one day a week, and still to this day, we started recording in 2010, and every time I read a new storyboard, I laugh out loud at least once. So I feel good about that. Look at the voice guy. I'm talking over here. I'm like, stay on axis. What's that about? Anyway, go ahead.
When you do record the show, do you record everybody in one room, or do you do individual in the booth?
We try to as much as possible. JG, the show's creator, who also voices Mordecai, really likes to have us all in one room at the same time. That's been harder. You know, Mark Hamill plays Skips. I think he's arguably most famous for that role, and he was gone working on some sci-fi movie for like weeks.
It'll never take.
I was like, are they going to replace that guy or what? I mean, yeah. But I'm sorry. What was the question?
Well, he skipped the job where he uses his voice to do a movie where he doesn't use it at all.
Yes. So I have heard.
Spoiler.
What's that? I don't know for sure, but I suspect he was doing other scenes.
Yeah.
He's very good about not sharing with us.
Yeah, he's learned over the years. Yeah, there's things you don't reveal. So, in kind of touching on regular show and your connection with Rigby, we thought it would be fun. It is election year.
Yes.
So we thought that it would be fun if Rigby ran for president.
Yeah.
What would his platform sound like?
Dude, pizza for everyone! And I think that'd be about it.
Yeah. So he's more of a socialist platform. Than
yes, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
I understand that.
And you know, with the understanding that he would always be first in line.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Something I was kind of touching on, it's not to go back to regular show, but hey, you guys like it, so we'll stick with it. Regular show, we were kind of talking about it before. It was a show that was just instantly popular. Like, it just blew up immediately. I was walking through a Toys R Us, you know, looking for, you know, random action figures. I'm like, what the hell is regular show? And it's like, oh, it's a show that premiered like last night. It's like, okay, great. And seeing it, it's like, okay, I understand now. Like, why do you think it just grabbed so instantly the way that it did?
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with the 80s homage. A lot of people like that period. A lot of people have fond memories of it. I was actually there for it, so I don't have many memories at all. But it really seemed to I think that spoke to a lot of people. By the way, I was right down the aisle from you in Toys R Us, standing in front of the toy, going, "Hey, cool dude! Hey, cool dude! Hey, cool dude!" Because I couldn't believe it. I was just.
You get a royalty every time you pull it.
No, but they had to pay me a little bit to have that happen. So that was nice.
So, Krysti, I know with regular show, a major portion, you know, of their time is spent playing video games, and you, of course, have a background in video games. So, do you have, when it comes to regular show, like, do you have any kind of video game questions that you'd like to ask Rigby?
What's Rigby's favorite video game?
Dig Jams, man. It rules 8-bit. It rules. Actually, lately, I don't know about Rigby because he's got crappy taste, but I've been really enjoying playing Fallout 4.
I wonder why.
Well, and not just that. Not just that.
No, it's a phenomenal game.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
It's amazing. It makes me weirdly hope for like a post-apocalyptic situation. Like, deep in my heart, if I woke up and I just had like power armor.
You know you're using your outside voice, right? When you say that.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, and of course, Courtney Taylor, my buddy, is Femme Soul Survivor, so that's pretty cool.
And she's here as well, somewhere.
She is here.
Just wandering aimlessly. Just...
Yeah, she is.
Full disclosure, Courtney? I killed you the other day.
Oh, awesome.
Totally shot Bullet in the face, so.
I think it's appropriate that Bullet gets shot.
Yeah.
He's kind of a jerk.
A little bit, yeah.
Anybody who threatens to wear your, what is it, wear your eyeballs for a necklace or something?
Something along those lines.
Wear your eyeballs for a necklace. Or not. Yeah, that's not cool. That was fun to do, though. I like playing bad guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How long does it take? Because with that kind of game, like, there's tons and tons of lines. Like,
yeah.
How long does it take to record that? Because you play multiple characters for one.
I did do multiple characters. That was a unique situation where the director was good. I was... having a good day. We moved really fast on that one. I think we recorded all three of my characters in a single 4-hour session.
Wow.
That's a good question. I don't. Games usually move really quickly. Mm-hmm. So you're kind of like, that's one of the things about being a voice actor. You have to kind of like show up and be ready and just go.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely.
What's the throat regimen for you, keeping your voice through all that? Because, I mean, you come to that parallel. Are you in danger of losing your voice afterwards?
It depends on the characters. I do a character in Evolve,
okay,
which is, he's the heavy support dude, Hank. And
because his voice is down here like this, it's like, we're going to drop in on that planet and kill some critters.
You know, that I really, if I'm going to do that for 4 hours, then I need to not do anything else for the rest of the day.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, but Rigby's not terribly stressful. Combat games, as you know, are famously stressful because, you know, that's the old joke about, okay, this is the sound of you dying by bayonet. Okay, now you're dying by hand grenade. Okay, now you're dying by flamethrower. And the thing of it is, you know, most of us are trained actors. They're doing VO. And you go through school and they say, okay, well, if you support your voice, you can do anything all day and it won't matter. So, you know, from drama school, you show up and you do a video game and they're like, okay, this is you dying of a flamethrower. And you go, ah! They're like, no, that's not gonna work. No, they want, ah! So, you know, you can only do that so long before.
We actually didn't get that. Can you take that again?
No.
Do you have a copy of that opera version, though, of the video game? I would love it.
That would be, like, a really great mod for a video game to replace all the death screen.
That's great.
La Folato.
Oh, I'm falling to my death.
Call of Duty 3 tenors.
You're onto something, man. I would leave here right now and patent that.
Do it.
There might be some other issues, but
I don't know if we can get a hold of the whole Call of Duty thing, but or the three tenors,
the
really.
Three tenors, yeah.
That's right. Well, one of them wouldn't have a problem.
Two tenors in an estate. Oh, I'm going to hell.
Oh, I got real dark there.
I should never have a live microphone. That's a horrible idea. Well, thank you very much.
Made fun of a dead guy. See you later.
And beat.
He was replaced later that week. Cartoon not work. Okay, I'm going to stop.
Something else that I was actually kind of intrigued by with Regular Show, it's we were kind of talking about, we're trying to figure out, you know, questions to ask so we don't look like complete morons.
You've never seen the show, have you?
No, I have seen the show. I'm a former preschool teacher, so yeah, I've seen the show. Because it's like, yeah, I don't want to watch Powerpuff Girls. Let's watch something different, please. And we wore out our copies of Animaniacs. So with Regular Show, we've kind of noticed a little bit, and it seems like animation's kind of going in this direction. It's animation's kind of going to a little bit lighter style. Like it's not like the 80s cartoons like G.I. Joe where they're flying through and there's jungles in the background and it's tons and tons of work and some poor guy in some country is just slaving over it. And it's a lot more simple design. Do you think that it's purely an economical reason everything's going to a simple design, or do you think it resonates with people better now?
No, I'm having fun. No. I'm sorry. No, that's
we told her to do that. Don't kill her.
They're all like, please, yes. Can we get the four? Can we? I don't think it's just economic. I mean, if you look at the way The Simpsons hit the scene, which was the Tracy Ullman show,
right?
Those original shorts were very, very simply drawn.
Right.
If you look at South Park, of course, and the famous example. Yeah. Yeah. Me too. I don't. You think we get away with some stuff, but but. You know, I think it's really a recognition of great writing. Is that the characters themselves are almost placeholders. You know, for great writing to occur, and I think that that's, I think there's just an acknowledgement of that. I think that it's in a way a compliment to the fans that it's not just about eye candy. It's about what characters are saying and doing and interacting.
Agreed, yeah. And actually, it's funny you bring it up because we were talking about Simpsons. I'm like, well, And that same thing with regular show, it's and Simpsons, like, you look at it like, oh, I could totally draw that. You hand somebody a pen, you can't draw that. Like, it looks simple, but it's really
right.
not.
And then you actually...
People come through through the lines, you know, and of course, Sam Marin is an amazing animator. J.G. Quintel, amazing animator. They get to be into, like, draw Rigby! And I'm like, dude, you don't want me to draw Rigby. You know, you'll spend your rest of your life telling people what that is. You don't want that.
I met Sam about an hour and a half ago.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know he doesn't use conditioner on his hair? Just naturally
he just,
beautiful?
He just looks that way, huh?
He's just beautiful, yeah.
Another reason to hate him.
I know.
Another mystery solved.
What's that?
Another great mystery solved.
Yeah. No, Sam is, I love working with Sam because Sam is the quietest dude. He's just very, like, self-contained and very quiet. And then he walks up to the, you know, I come to work. It's like, hey, Sam, how you doing? Fine. Okay, cool. So you having a good day? Yeah. Okay, let's start with Muscle Man. My mom! And he's just like full body. I mean, Sam is really, and he is a great artist. He's a great animator, but he's also just a really fine actor.
Awesome.
And he also, his favorite food is chili dogs. The more you know.
That's right. And who could argue with that, really?
You can't.
Yeah.
You can't. Yeah.
What's that? Oh, to go to eat wings together? We all have different spice ratings, you know? I'm a really, really... I was about to say, I'm a really hot guy. No, I like...
What is your spice rating?
I like my wings really spicy, so, you know, I got to go by myself. It's dangerous.
he's looking at me, he's like, we know what to say.
I am killing up here. I'm killing. Save me, Spider-Man.
You know, I feel bad now because on that note, we're actually out of time. I don't want to kick him off after he just gave this thing.
I was like thinking about your hot guy joke and then looking at her saying 1 minute, and I was
just like.
Yeah, okay. Do I have time for one question?
Yeah, we got time.
Please
for
save us.
Oh, hey.
What's up?
Let's say your question.
How do you do your voice like Ribby's?
That's a great question. What's your name?
Eddie.
Eddie? Eddie wants to know how I do my voice like Rigby. Well, I drink about a pot and a half of coffee. And, you know, I wake up in the morning and I sound kind of like this. I drink the pot and a half coffee, and before I know it, I sound like this. And suddenly I'm like, stop talking! Thanks for the question. That was a good one.
That was great.
You guys were all great. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Bill.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, William. Bill,
we're gonna move over here. We got two guests coming to us right now.
You know what?
Yeah.
I did the last one. You do this one.
We did the last one.
I got that one.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Cool. So we have actually two guests.
Right.
So
I'm gonna move over here so they can.
You want me to move?
Yeah. If you wanna, and then da da da.
We're going to change the format in the middle of the show. I'm actually going to move over to this side.
What are you doing?
Well, guests are...
I was trying to accommodate.
Well,
now you're making things
doing
difficult.
This the whole time. It's kind of weird.
What are you doing?
Making it really awkward. I figured we could put them right here.
We're going to put them in the right center.
Okay.
There.
That way
the
we
guests.
Can, like...
You just don't want to sit next to me.
Yeah, I don't.
It's okay. I get a lot.
There we go.
All right, so our next guest is not the sound guy. It is... From the death of Superman Returns, please welcome Holly Payne and Josh Schnepp. Jon Schnepp. Damn it, I'm so sorry.
Amateur hour at Supercon.
This is
hour.
Why I need to write notes. I'm so sorry. See, this is why you should have introduced them, because I screwed it up.
You guys, had the list. You
I
had
owned
the list.
It at least. So I apologize, Holly and John. Can you please introduce yourselves better than I did?
My name is Greg Scrimps.
Okay.
How's it going, everybody?
I'm Jill Flimbles. And
So we worked on the movie The Resurrection of Superman again. What happened? So thanks for coming by.
All right, so first, to be serious.
We were just having a really awesome conversation about
actually.
Chimps. When you go to the zoo and they throw their shit at you. It was pretty awesome. Kids, how many of you have ever seen a chimp drink another chimp's urine? Yeah. No, no, not on YouTube, in real life. You got to go to the zoo to experience this. So you family members here with children, I highly recommend you taking them to the zoo and just hang out in the primate section for like maybe an hour, and you will see sights.
It's better than any reality TV show.
You'll such see. Sights to show you, their as own Pinhead urine? Would say.
Their own urine or like, well, like kind of like passing back and forth?
I remember when I was five, there was one chimp, and it was just like looking at us, peeing on the glass, and the other chimp was just licking it up. Like, so they were doing, they like to do shows for you, and they do that kind of stuff to like mess with you. They're like, I'm messing with the humans. They know it'll mess you up.
They have a plot.
And we were in Australia just like a couple months ago. We went to the zoo there, and a chimp, she's got it on film, a chimp just started pooing and like collecting it in its hand, and we were like, what? I was like, we were hoping it would throw it.
Behind the glass, we were watching this chimp, you know, take a dump in his hand. He handled all of it. None of it went anywhere except his hand. And talent. Then we saw this whole line of people watching it happen.
Yeah.
And then he just went,
and like satisfying giant big
the
bite
whole,
of turd.
We saw the perspective. We were in the perspective of seeing the whole group.
Everyone
of
was like this, oh. But we couldn't hear them because we were behind this glass. It was like this weird silent movie. We were all behind the chimp. We're like, that's right, eat that poo. And he's like, and then just kind of lumbered away. Like, my mission
no,
is done.
He started
done.
Running and screaming. Yeah.
Excitedly. So
it wasn't,
our poo story.
Wasn't anger. He was happy about it. It was a good choice.
Very excited that he grossed out most of the audience. So I would do that, I guess, if I was in a cage.
Yeah.
Eventually.
What
not
else
right
are you
off the
do?
Bat. No, she's like, liar. All right, the second day I would eat my own poo. But the first day I'd be like, I'm not doing it.
You don't want to play the hits immediately. You wait.
So that people actually do know what we do and right. who we are. We made a film called The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, which is all about the Tim Burton, Nicolas Cage Superman film that was almost made in 1998.
Kevin Smith wrote it.
Kevin Smith was the first screenwriter, and Tim Burton was going to direct it. And Warner Brothers pulled the plug on it about 2-3 weeks before they were going to start shooting. But that's what we've been working on for the past few years. In addition to that, we also worked on a film called The ABCs of Death, which you guys should see.
No one under 18, so that's half the audience
yeah.
here.
And then way back in the 90s, I was the lips of MTV's Liquid Television, which I don't know if anybody...
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Wow. So that goes way back.
I perk up for Liquid Television. Sorry, I'm sorry about that. Like, oh, okay, great.
That was his trigger word.
I'm just surprised somebody else remembered it.
We're going to have to calm down all night now.
And John's worked on a bunch of really cool stuff.
A lot of Adult Swim stuff. Once again, not for children, half the audience. Metalocalypse, Venture Brothers, Aqua Teen Hunger Force, Space Ghost, Coast Coast, how I got started. I got started editing Space Ghost back in the late 90s, so that was a lot of fun.
Awesome.
It was basically making television to mess people's brains up. I was like, I like this.
So success.
Kept doing it, yeah. They can't stop me.
Psychotic, making psychotic cartoons.
So here we are in Miami. What's up, Miami?
What's up?
Yeah.
Woo!
Hey, why is it so humid? Can you guys do something about that? Just kidding. Right, Bill Nye, the science guy, please fix Miami. Wait a minute. I'm not saying it needs to be fixed like there's a problem, but at least you guys get rain. We've been promised El Nino, and I was like, thank God it's going to rain like a month. 2 days. Less than two. It does, but still, it doesn't matter.
Not like that chimp.
Not even a full 2 days of rain, and then it was like back to endless sun. So at least you guys get rain. So, you know, I wouldn't complain about that. But the weird humidity.
Keeps all the cigars fresh down here.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, that's what it's for.
At least there is that, yeah.
I should smoke a cigar or something. Mm-hmm. I'm a sweaty nerd, and I'm extra sweaty out here. I can't stop sweating. I'm like, when do I? I guess I don't.
I have a question.
Constant sweat.
I have a question, not being from Miami. This is my first time in Miami, actually.
That's right.
What are the like the most obscure, awesome things about Miami? Like, the first thing that comes to your mind.
Depending upon what street you drive on, there's bags of dead chickens on the side of the road.
Yep.
That's more of a Hialeah thing,
what?
Though.
What? Are they plucked?
That's legit. Not.
Or are they just like some kind of? I killed a bunch of chickens and put them in a bag.
I don't know. It's.
Don't it depends just on like the neighborhood.
It really does depend
it really
on the neighborhood.
Depends on that. Sometimes it's food. Sometimes it's sacrifice.
I,
you know.
Yeah, I'm.
But it's
not,
like
I wish I were joking.
Here, right?
Now, kids, when we say chickens, what we're talking about is giant chocolate eggs.
Exactly.
Just along the side of a road in a bag, a dirty bag. So don't open it. I'm talking to these three children. Right here. Okay.
Like, well, they know what we're talking about.
Like the dirty bag of eggs. Don't open it. The dirty bag of eggs. The bag is sweating.
So to kind of get back to the reason you guys, and again, I'm so very sorry for completely botching the opening.
It has nothing to do with Superman Returns whatsoever.
No, it doesn't. And honestly, if I can try and redeem myself a little bit, it could be because of what Superman Returns is. I want it to die. So that's probably what I was thinking. So I apologize. But before we get into anything, this actually started from, it's a Kickstarter project, and it's a very successful, like one of the first big successful Kickstarter projects, right?
Yeah, I mean, well, I had done a Kickstarter the year before and raised money for an animated short, and it was a big success. Mm-hmm. So a year later, I had just been really interested in this failed project. It was just a personal thing that I was into. Like, everyone probably has weird stuff on their computer that you're like, don't open that folder. So this was like, this is a folder like, go ahead and open it. You won't be happy about it. It's just a bunch of weird drawings. But it was something that I was into. And, you know, I decided to, like, try to turn it into a feature film and made a Kickstarter. And everybody really responded to it. So I remember talking to a lot of people outside of Holly, but a lot of people were like, why do you want to do that? She understood it because she was like, oh, I get it. You're interested in that. You might as well try it. And Kickstarter is a great way to test things out to see if there is an actual audience for it. And there was. So we raised the money. And then I originally thought we could do it in like a year, but it took way longer than that, like almost three times as long. But we were very happy with the outcome of it. So, you know, sometimes you can't rush something. It was like, I didn't even know what the story really was going to be. I had like a rough outline, but it just kind of grew as we made it.
It really developed organically, but one of the things that really worked out well for us, obviously, was the fact that we got to talk to everybody who had actually worked on the film. So we interviewed Tim Burton in England back in 2014, and we flew out to England not even knowing if we were going to get that interview. We hadn't, you know, he hadn't met us, but we met with him for 15 minutes. He liked us, and then 2 days later, we were shooting him at his house. Mm-hmm. And it was really cool, because I think that up until that point, I think he was still beaten up about it, you know? It was he spent so much time and heart and soul on that film, and then, you know, never got to see it to fruition, so.
Right. And that's a fantastic interview. You really got Tim to really open up about it. Like,
it's unlike any other Tim Burton interview ever.
It is. And as I was watching it, like, I was kind of looking at it, I'm like, I don't know. And like, Tim Burton's going to be real cagey about this. And as I was watching it, like,
cagey.
He's not cagey at all. Yeah, well,
I see what he did there. Bam.
I wish I were that talented.
She got it first.
I've never heard that one before.
yeah, I'm sure.
But no, it was a fantastic interview. You really got him to open up about it. And even making jokes about it, like it was kind of surreal at first.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know what's fun? Like, everyone I've interviewed on the film was really like, when I interview anybody, ever have any kind of like, I'm not. The only person I probably, if I ever had to talk to, like William Shatner, I'd be like, Mr. Shatner again.
Yeah, but you sat on Shatner's lap, though. So.
Huh? Oh yeah, but I'm just saying, like, I don't really get, you know. So, and I'm really just upfront. So I think that breaks down any kind of weird barriers. And he's also an artist. I'm an artist, so it just felt like we just instantly clicked. Mm-hmm. So I mean, same thing with John Peters, though. To be honest with you,
yeah.
Like interviewing John Peters. John Peters is the guy. If you ever saw Kevin Smith do his thing where he's talking about when he wrote the Superman movie, John Peters is the producer that hired him who wanted him to add a giant spider and fight polar bears. So, I mean, he's really been like kind of the butt of Kevin Smith's jokes.
Right.
You know, and
nobody knew really who he was. He was sort of this mysterious entity that had become exactly that, nothing more than a joke. Mm-hmm. And then when you actually hear him speak, you know, there's a lot that Kevin says that rings true when
totally
John Peters
true.
Speaks. But at the same time, you also kind of get where he was coming from.
Right.
And you also understand why he wanted a giant spider. And it's like, when you hear his perspective on it, it's like, he's not a superhero guy. He never read comics. And he was coming from it like, look, man, all I know is like these other Superman movies, he fought a dude. I want him to fight something that's bigger and giant, like something that's threatening. What about a giant, like that Nautilus creature from, you know, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, the squid? I want him to fight a big thing. So it makes sense when you're coming from his perspective. It's just not an informed comic book person's perspective who would be like, dude, there's like a million characters that already exist in the Superman world that you can make and fight. You don't have to create like a weird spider.
Yeah.
That's where that all that stuff comes from. But it's great to understand and hear that from all the different perspectives.
To see a different, and it definitely with his perspective, it's like you're saying he doesn't come from a comic book background, but he clearly comes from a cinema background because he mentioned, you know, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. He said that he went ahead a King Kong moment. So, like, he definitely, he has an informed opinion.
He started very early. I mean, he was, like, cast, I think, in Ben-Hur or something when he was, like, 10 years old.
Wow.
So he was in Hollywood for many, many years. Mm. But he also had incredibly successful projects that you don't get to that level of, you know, that mega producer status without having had a lot of success before that. One of the things that I love about John Peters, not many people know that he was responsible for the gopher in Caddyshack. So, you know, besides the spider.
It wasn't in the movie. It wasn't in the movie. And he added it, and then he was like, I hired ILM, we built these things. So they shot all that after the film was done. He added the gopher.
Was it like a wedding present to Kenny Loggins?
Probably, yeah. I mean, as a gopher, it's like, all right. That's just like, whenever we were listening to like Quentin Tarantino yesterday through, what's the podcast called?
Well, it's pretty obscure. Nobody would know it here. It's BBC Six Music from the UK.
But it's like really about like how, you know, musical score and how at least Tarantino has like been, you know, embedded that when you hear a song, especially for many of his films, you instantly think of that, you know, that scene where Michael Madsen's dancing, he's going to cut that cop's ear off. You know that song. When you hear it, it's like, you know, it's like...
Put the lime in the coconut, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That was the last song in the film.
So, yeah, I mean, anyway, that's music. John Peters, like, definitely very... music has been a part of all of his films. Mm. So it's been a really cool thing.
He's also been in 500 Street Fights.
That's right.
All right. All right. Yeah.
But I like that it's over five. It's not...
He says, I've been in over 500 street fights.
Yeah, so is it 501 or is it 732? Right. But it's definitely more than 500.
It's more than 500. Yeah, I'm sure. Some with polar bears.
No, he's incredibly strong. He choked me out after we were done with the interview.
Oh.
We heard all these stories about him, like, choking people out.
Well,
and, like,
he'd been in the film. You actually see the art department, you know, they're talking about, well, he would come to the art department, he'd, you know, blow through the art department, and then he would put Rick Heinrichs, the production designer, in a headlock. And, like, you know, disrupt
demonstrating
everybody's...
Demonstrating a kung fu move or a karate move.
Right. And so by the end of the interview, we had developed a rapport with him. And I said, Mr. Peters, I have one final question. And feel free to say no if you like. But would you put John in a headlock? And his face lit up. He was like, yeah.
And I was totally cool with it at first, too. I was like, yeah, choke me out, whatever. And he gets behind me, and he just, that dude... He's almost 70. That guy is strong.
He's 70 now.
Because,
yeah,
like, literally everything started getting black. She got a photo, or I thought she did. And I was like, all right.
Don't twist the story. You do it every time.
It's not
the real story.
It's my version of it.
You've changed it in your mind.
All right, what really happened, Holly?
What really happened was I was moving his mic pack because it was in the way, and so I couldn't get his photo because I wasn't in the position to.
Oh, I know why I couldn't concentrate on what was really happening, because I was getting choked out. So I couldn't concentrate on what was happening.
Yeah, so he put him in a sleeper hold twice.
So then she got the second time, and I swear to God, I would not want to fight John Peters. That guy is strong. And he's a black belt. Totally kicked my ass.
But it's a really fascinating look at you know, in a movie that would have been a mega blockbuster, and the fact that this happens so often in Hollywood, this is one of the most, I think, I mean, I'm not tooting our own horns, we really got in depth with what happens behind the scenes. Stuff you'll never be able to see. You see movies, but you don't realize what goes into making them a lot of the time.
Yeah, like, you know what was really eye-opening is, like, it is pure development hell, but, like, you'll hear about a movie and it gets announced, like, a couple years ago, and then you'll hear, oh, they just got this actor or this actress, and, you know, they're going to be in the film. Once it gets a couple months after that and they've set a date for the release of the film, especially if it's like a bigger budget, like a science fiction or a superhero film, there's mountains and mountains and mountains of people producing artwork and concept designs and set designs and maquettes and costume designs.
And wait till you see what they were making, because it is
so cool.
Breathtakingly beautiful. Yeah.
But really, that happens
with... That suit is amazing.
That's what I'm saying.
The vacuum form suit is amazing.
It happens with so many movies. This is just... Our film is just indicative of the development hell process. Mm-hmm. So.
And you were kind of talking...
What's a maquette?
What's a what?
I'm sorry. What's a maquette? Yeah.
What's a maquette?
John, you want to describe a maquette?
A Oh, it's a maquette. It's like a it's a miniature, like somebody made, like, oh, this is like, instead of somebody building a, you'll hear sometimes, oh, it's 1/6 scale. Uh-huh. For like a nerd who's like, I bought a hot toy, it's 1/6 scale. Well, where that comes from is like, you know, Peter Hobbit's the, you know
Peter Hobbit.
Peter Hobbit, he's my friend. He made this thing called the Jackson. So anyway, he's like, he made these 1/16th scale or 1/6 scale models that you could actually shoot. So it's like, it's a smaller version of a life-size thing. So, you know, these action figures are 1/6 scale or something like that. A maquette is like a fully made, like, clay monster or character or creature, so you can see it, and the producer and director can turn around and look at it before you say, all right, go ahead and make that thing full size.
It's a prototype.
Prototype.
That's awesome. Yeah. Sorry, my ADHD kicked in when I heard that.
Don't worry.
I'm like,
maquette.
What?
I found a word I don't know.
What is a baguette? No, not that. It's not a baguette. What is that? Is there two T's? Does it come with cream cheese?
Craft services is involved already. I love it.
Hey, what bring me for is the croissant, 1/6 scale. Those are tiny croissants for the kids in the audience. I want 17 croissants, 1/16th scale. I want them covered in butter.
Tin
floating
scale
in butter.
All right.
Yeah. They would literally float in butter if they were that tiny.
You had
I want
me
the
floating
heart
butter.
Special.
Anything floating in butter sounds great
it's
to me. So, I mean, this is just, can we make
Seven
that movie?
Wasps it's floating in butter.
That should be a band name. Yeah.
Floating in butter. We are floating in butter.
We're here to sing our song about heart attacks. Yeah, so this, our first song, Floating in Butter, presents Bacon, Bacon, Bacon. Yeah.
It's when Black Angus sponsors a metal band.
Yeah. Their first album is called Bypass. You want to play the game?
We forgot about the game.
All right. So for your audience members don't know, of course, when we have someone who knows so much about comic books, we always like to, we've all had this debate, who would win in a fight, X versus X. So we're going to give you X versus X. I pull randomly, but we're also going to put a location, because location matters sometimes. So I'm going to pull the two superheroes. Chrissy's going to pull the place, and then we'll see what your decisions are and who's going to win this. All right, so we first have, and we didn't put Superman in here because that's not fair.
Impossible Man. No, just kidding.
We got Iron Man. Iron Man versus the Green Lantern.
In space.
Oh, damn. Someone just got effed.
Take it, John.
So I would say, you know, maybe they're pals. They're hanging out having a sandwich. They're on a satellite or something.
A baguette.
Right.
Yeah. Tony Stark is not in his Iron Man outfit. He's having like 7 or 8 small croissants all floating in butter. And he's like...
floating in
butter. He sees Green Lantern, Hal Jordan. And
floating
John,
in space
I'd
butter.
I'd say it's Hal Jordan... and Jon Stewart. They're just chilling from the Green Lantern Corps. You know, they got their rings, but they're also not in their outfits. They're just hanging out. Maybe they're making the bacon, bacon, bacon special.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And Tony Stark's over there. He's like about to take a giant bite of this tiny micro croissant. And he says, hey, hang on a second. I had 7 little baby croissants all floating here. And I turn away for like a quick second. I'm like checking my phone. And now there's like 1. And I'm like, what are you guys chewing on over there? And they're both like turned away, like, nothing, man, doing that. It's Tony Stark all the way, because instantly clicks that button, Iron Man outfit, right? And then he clicks another button, the entire satellite just explodes. And before the Green Lanterns can like activate a shield, they die. Because, you know, like Green Lanterns, they can't breathe in space, but Iron Man has an oxygen tank mask, all that kind of crazy stuff, and he just watches those guys explode.
I was almost thinking you were going to have that the rings slipped off because of all the butter on their hands.
Ooh. That's PG version. Kids, you know what really happened? Iron Man didn't kill the Green Lanterns. What happened is the rings slipped off from all that excess butter, and then Iron Man just like gently...
rendered really, almost powerless.
Like almost like a caress. A gentle green caress of an energy shield hugging in a gentle and non-sexual way, hugging the Green Lanterns.
Butter.
And extricating them from the space satellite and back to Earth really quick style. So that's what happened. Not really much of a fight. Just an anger over the harsh usage of butter.
Butterfingers.
Yeah. Ooh, nice. Butterfingers. Then he opened up the you know, weird vault with like 40 other micro food elements. All ready to be
floating. That's how it would go.
How are we topping that battle afterwards?
Yeah, right? Yeah. Who else is on the satellite? I don't know.
Let's see who we got else. All right. I've got Batman. All right.
Nice.
Got Batman. And he's going to go against Bouncing Boy.
Ooh.
Yeah. This is stiff competition here.
Now, here, let me just double check here. Like, all you nerds out there, fact check. Bouncing Boy. Now, was it Bouncing Lad, or does Bouncing Boy have anything to do with Matter Eater Lad? Are they the same, or are they different?
They're different. We had to look it up, because we didn't know either.
Okay, we didn't want to get crucified.
Because I remember Matter Eater Lad, is he also fat? That's one I can't remember. Because Matter Eater Lad, we're talking about these weird characters from the 31st century.
Right.
What is it called?
The Legion of Superheroes.
Legion of Superheroes. I always remember that I always was pissed off about Bouncing Boy.
Bouncing Boy.
I
want
to keep saying Bouncing Lad because it's all of it so dumb.
Mm-hmm. I think it should be Bouncing Boy versus Spider-Ham, right?
Peter Porker, the amazing
Spider-Ham. Peter Porker,
Spider-Ham.
Right. Absolutely.
Well, yeah, Batman, I think, it's not really, it's not fair. I mean, because Batman would just be like, first of all, he'd stare Bouncing Boy down, and Bouncing Boy would just be crying. Right. Just because of Batman's ability to stare him down. Like, not even ever having to lift a glove or any kind of fight, just the pure anger and violence that's inside of Batman staring at anyone could reduce you to like, make him stop, whatever. And especially if you're Bouncing Boy, get out of here. Well, nope, it's not happening.
There's a location factor, though.
Oh, what's the location?
Here we go.
I can confirm Matter Eater Lad is not fat.
Oh. Okay.
I just Google imaged him.
No, he's just got a really dumb outfit.
Yeah.
Wow. That's a long looking location.
Yeah, it's Hulk Hogan's racial awareness party.
Whoa.
So.
Damn. All right. Well.
I'm sorry. Can I just say Batman versus anything?
Yeah. It's a rough one.
I think Batman just automatically wins.
Okay.
Anywhere.
Okay. Cool.
Yep.
Even Superman.
Automatic win.
Hulkster or no Hulkster?
Do you stop bouncing? You will. Boo! Yay! Whatever. Hey, I can't wait for that movie. Anybody who says that movie's going to suck, I will fight you. With Bouncing Boy's power, or whatever his name is. I'm going to bounce you out of the convention. I'm going to bounce you out of this planet and onto the satellite with the Green Lanterns. Covered in butter.
Butterfingers.
That's right. Coated in butter.
One more.
This is the best off the rails game I've ever played so far. I love it.
Batman slipped on butter. All right, what's the next question?
We got Magneto.
Yes. Come on. Yeah. Y'all quiet. Magneto.
Come on, Magneto.
Magneto versus the Hulk.
Magneto.
Ooh, that's good.
Oh yeah, where's the location?
Where's the location?
Atlantis.
Did you say Atlantis?
Yeah.
Why did you write Atlantis?
Yeah, you
it's
know
not
what?
Even a real
no, no,
place.
No, 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 no.
Oh,
not
right, Aquaman.
No, not the Kingdom Atlantis. Sure. The resort.
Ooh. Oh, the resort Atlantis. Okay. There we go.
God damn.
That's
I'd say
way
the Hulk
better.
Wins.
Yeah.
The Hulk wins because there's nothing metal in Atlantis. That's such a cheap resort. Everything's plastic. Like, Magneto keeps trying to move stuff, and the Hulk is just punching him. And he just becomes this shredded corpse. Right, kids? Magneto becomes a shredded corpse. And when I say shredded corpse, I mean a burrito.
Girl superheroes yet, by
a
the
human
way.
Burrito. Is what the,
you will.
You guys saw the Avengers? Remember the Hulk's doing that stuff to Loki? That's Magneto. But just imagine the flesh being torn off. Just kidding.
And then he eats a baguette with
just imagine Magneto floating in butter. And then the Hulk eats him. A 1/6 scale Magneto covered in a burrito, deep fried, floating in butter.
Magneto and then burrito.
Hulk hungry.
So we just got totally called out for being very patriarchal, so I'm going to invent two female superheroes off the top.
What happened to
and
the
that's
women?
What we get for doing this last minute and not thinking of these things.
I know I wrote Wonder Woman down.
All right, Krysti, give me the name of a female superhero you like.
Kitty Pryde.
Okay.
Nice.
All right, I'm going to pick Psylocke, okay?
Okay.
There we go. Well, X-Men versus X-Men. Where are they fighting?
Compton.
All right.
Yes.
I think that Psylocke has the advantage on this. I mean, Kitty Pryde can phase. Also, I'm sorry. Let me get sweaty for a minute. What age Kitty Pryde? Is this like the old school John Byrne, Chris Claremont Kitty Pryde, or is this like nowadays badass Kitty
Pryde? Let's go with the Joss Whedon version. Let's go with that. Was it Astonishing?
Sure, X-Men? Sure.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Let's go with that one.
Because that upset Annie a little bit.
Yeah.
And it makes it a little more even. I'm going to give it to Kitty Pryde just because Psylocke's dumb.
Ooh.
She's hot, dumb. But she's kind of a big bag of dumb. So
Kitty Pryde's end of this, Kitty Pryde's walking straight out of Compton.
Kitty Pryde is like a computer engineer.
Even have to describe how, it's not even a violent way she beats her. She just beats her in like some amazing book smart
stuff.
No,
give us the details. You got to give us some details.
Yeah, they're fighting
Compton. Details.
Is she blood or crip?
She's tough. All right, so we're hanging out at Compton, and let's see. Kitty Pryde just got this delicious little tiny catfish sandwich floating in butter. It's like this cup of butter.
Wow, you've been to Compton before.
It's just a cup with a couple of catfish, deep fried, floating in butter. And she just ate three of them. She's like, oh my God, this is so good. Sips on a very sweet tea, delicious sweet tea. Sits down, and then she sees Psylocke talking mad shit across the street, like, nah, kick Kitty Pryde's ass, and like doing some dumb stuff with a sword. So Kitty Pryde just like calmly puts the catfish that's floating in butter, just puts it down, walks across the street. I'm sorry, I thought I heard you say something about me and how you kicked my ass. What was that about? Psylocke just starts crying instantly. I didn't know it was going to be like this. And then that's it.
This
is for the butter multiverse.
Yeah.
Right, kids? Just got cleared up with no violence.
I'm enjoying this version.
You ever hear somebody talking mad crap about you, just call them out. That's all I'm saying.
Awesome.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, well, thank you guys so much. This has been really fun.
It's been very, very educational.
I have learned a lot.
I have to thank the three children in the front row for keeping me somewhat non-X-rated.
All right.
I'll see you guys later, floating in butter.
I mean, you can also come to our booth 531 tomorrow if you want to check out The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened.
That's right, it's right outside.
Give them a round of applause, guys. They're leaving. Come on now. There we go.
Thank you. All right, I screwed up the last one. I'm not doing it.
All right, no problem. Give Krysti something to do, man.
Yeah, Jesus.
I'm sorry.
Let's go.
I went for the reach, and he was like, no.
It's because you don't want to sit next to me.
Well, you can stay over there with that attitude. All right. Oh, up next, we have some of my favorite people, Azzyland and Karli Woods.
All right, let's bring them on up.
Yeah. There's some girls up in this.
Hi. Oh, you just came back from work, huh?
I don't know how you
do this. Oh, wow, look at that. Yeah. There we go.
Can we? Are you good?
Yeah, I got it.
Ooh. That is impressive. Wow.
The outfit or that she can sit in the chair?
A little bit of both, yeah.
Yeah, somebody actually came to my booth and they were like, some girl dressed as Charizard like knocked me in the face and I think I'm bruising. And I was
no.
That sounds terrible.
We almost had
a rough life at Comic-Con.
Yeah.
We almost fell down the escalator together as well. Yeah, it wasn't very good.
Yeah, somebody was like, yeah, I got knocked out.
I'm really clumsy and it's really big.
You've had that on all day as well.
Yeah, it hurts.
You tried peeing in this thing.
I can't even imagine. I would just wear a diaper for sure.
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea.
It's a really good idea.
They should make cosplay Depends. They really should.
Cosplay
Depends.
Cosplay diapers.
Yeah, because it smells so great at a convention already.
Boom, boom.
Just stuff it with potpourri. You're good. It's fine. No one's going to know. It's a whole, like... con smell. No one's going to...
Con smell. Everyone knows the con smell.
Yeah. No one's going to like point the finger at any one person and be like, you're the cause of the smell because you peed in your costume. No one's going to know. You're fine.
Yeah,
you're
no
fine.
One will know.
You're fine.
Conventions would be
held
outside.
So we're telling you to pee in your pants. That's what we're doing right now. We're telling you it's okay.
This is a great topic we've let off on.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I don't know.
We've milked like 3 minutes out of it. I'm impressed.
Why do we keep going towards that? We opened up the last one. We were talking about monkeys peeing. Now we're talking about peeing in a depend.
It's late. That's what happens.
It is late.
Everyone here is pooped.
That's a good pun.
Yay, dad joke. Okay, so go ahead and introduce yourselves because I'm terrible at it. You are?
I'm Azzy. I go by Azzyland.
And I am Karli Woods, and that's my name.
I like
you
it.
You weirdo going by good. Your real name. Like me. So it's fine. I feel you.
Well, my YouTube show and my website is Geek and Gorgeous.
Oh, okay. There we go.
.com?
.org?
Geekandgorgeous.com.
Cool. Oh, geekandgorgeous.com. Check it out. Plug. So where do we get the Azzyland from? What's that like from?
Well, my real name's Azra, and okay. Everyone calls me Azzy, and when I was growing up, it was really like tough being a female gamer. Like people thought I was really weird, and
oh yeah.
They kind of judged me for it, and I kind of wanted to create this like positive place where anyone can like feel accepted and anyone can like anyone can be happy, and I just wanted to like make people's days better, I guess. So that's kind of where Azzyland came from.
Like really nice. I'm not gonna make fun of it at all.
Don't you dare.
And yeah. I'm just like, no, I
can't. Not everyone's happy in Azzyland.
I won't destroy that beautiful world. That's
no, I know that struggle.
I kind of want to live in Azzyland now. This is a magical place.
It's like Disneyland, but for gamers and geeks.
Wow.
Yeah. That should be your slogan. You're welcome.
Thank you.
We're workshopping up here.
Yeah, your banner is really cute as well. It looks like a fun place to be. Your like little Azzyland like banner. Yeah.
Azzyland, the fun nice. Place.
It's very like Lisa Frank aesthetic. Like just anybody who knows me, I like kind of like I'm always like off in a different world. Like I'm not really fully here. No. So yeah.
Yes, we made that clear in the green room.
What happened in the green room? I spilled all of it.
She's wearing the green room.
There is no more green room, guys. Sorry. So as another female gamer, which these two dudes, I guess, can't relate, so I'll
hey, that's not fair. I am not a female gamer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, sorry.
No, I don't remember any of that. No. I mean, there was that one time in Vegas where technically I was a female gamer for like 24 hours, but other than that, we're good.
That stayed there, so.
That stayed right there. Yeah. That was a weird couple of days.
I was named Louise.
I know.
Yeah.
I totally forgot what I was going to ask her.
Sorry, I'm done. So, fellow female gamer.
You do a lot of work on Twitch, right?
Yeah, and I just started a YouTube channel, too.
Oh, you did? Good, good. Very good. Oh, yeah, you've been doing a lot of hosting stuff, right? Like little, like...
I've been doing a lot of hosting, but I just started my own personal channel where I do a lot of gaming news. Mm-hmm. I want to start doing cosplay tutorials on there. And I also want to do some like let's plays, but mostly right now gaming news and like things that I'm passionate about.
Yeah, let's plays are super popular. Yeah. There's like a huge audience for that kind of stuff. How do you find being a female gamer on Twitch? Because I hate it.
You know what? And that's the thing. It's like I love this, and why do people have to like ruin it for me?
Yeah, it's really difficult being a female and doing the YouTube thing as well. Like I used to do YouTube, I used to do Twitch, and I just couldn't handle the colorful cast of characters in the comments section.
I'm not on Twitch, but my YouTube isn't negative at all. My YouTube
nice
has
for you.
Been, yeah, it's been very nice. It's been a good ride.
My advice to that is that, like, why are you going to give attention to that, like, one or five people who are being negative when you have another, like, 1,000 who are, like, love you and who are giving you this positive attention? You're not giving them your time of day. You're giving your time of day to this person who's being negative. I just ignore it. I pretend it doesn't happen because they just don't deserve it.
Yeah, you can't feed the trolls for sure.
Can't feed the trolls. Mike.
Which it's so interesting that there's such a negative feedback to kind of, you know, we're entering this new era where it's more of a equal sexual nerddom world, and there's still this resistance out there, and it's like you're fighting someone because they're playing in your same imaginary world. Like, it's not like there's no thing off. It's like, no, you can't play Mario 2.
Like, you would think like it would be more inclusive,
right?
But it's weirdly not. I mean, there's still a lot of good within the gaming community. But back years and years ago, I used to be a professional gamer with like Halo and stuff like that, Counter-Strike. And I was much younger when I was doing the competitive gaming. And I don't ever remember the community being that bad when I was doing tournaments and playing games competitively. It was very much like girls were kind of new to the competitive scene, and it was very warm and welcoming and nice. And to me, it almost seems like the past like 5 years is when things got kind of off the rails as far as female gaming goes. And I think it's because females feel more comfortable coming out as being like geeky and gaming and stuff. And I think there's like a weird like competitive issue with people.
Yeah, does like guys feel like they're not being able to get their spotlight as much because they feel like girls are overshining them.
Yeah, because I really feel like, to me at least, and I've been doing the whole gaming thing for like a million years because I'm really old, and I just feel like... No, I am.
No.
Yes.
No.
And I
you guys
I just
won't know
like...
their ages. We're just going to play this game for the next 5 minutes.
We're way smart enough not to ask.
Yeah. Good boys. Yeah, but I feel like the last 5 years, it's been like really, really negative, at least for me.
No, I completely agree with you, especially like some communities like League of Legends, really, really, really bad.
It's a scary place.
Like, I almost sometimes pretend I'm a guy when I play, because
yeah,
it's easier.
Absolutely. But it's hard for me, because normally my gamer tag is just my name, Krysti Pryde, so it's kind of like, well, you can see right through it, but yeah. There's been a lot of games that I've been playing recently. I've been using a more gender-neutral name, and it's been so much better, which is really sad.
It really is. It shouldn't be like that.
Like, no, it shouldn't.
At the end of the day, like, we're all just gamers. It doesn't matter whether we're like female, male, what our race is, what our age is.
Right.
What, you
know? I just wonder why.
There's got to be some kind of social origin to this. There's something must have happened. 2010, 2011, when you said this shift happened, that created such a hostile environment, and it might just be this, just frustration, amount of frustration in people, and it could be something even more than just gaming. It's something that this is like a whole thesis that you could go into socioeconomic problems going on. I mean, who even knows? You know, people's lives are horrible type of thing, and then they see. They see people getting more attention than them, and they lose hope, and they attack because they can't defend. You know, this is
a really good point. The division has been really strange, and I'm sure there's a lot of things that contribute to it. Like, I know women just by nature tend to be more competitive with each other, I think.
Yeah.
And so I think I've noticed there's a lot of girl-on-girl hate in the community as well, which is very off-putting to me.
Yeah, I hate that.
I think there needs to be, obviously, a more, like, a bigger sense of solidarity with female gamers, and I've noticed kind of the opposite. I don't do competitive events anymore, but I notice, like, just the constant hate on social media, Twitch, YouTube.
They're, like, feeding it more. Like, the thing that they hate, they're feeding it.
Yeah, so. I mean, I think the women are just being... And that with cosplay being so prominent, and I feel like it's another element for girls to be competitive with. Like, everyone has to be, like, the best girl gamer or, like, the best cosplayer.
You know what? Someone's success doesn't undermine your own success.
No, absolutely.
At the end of the day. So someone else being successful doesn't affect you.
Right.
So I don't see that. I don't understand why they're like that.
It's that idea. It's like you run your own race. There's no who can get to the top first. You put the blinders on. And it's what time you finish is that personal best for you. And it's something that is probably lost by a lot of people.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people. Yes. Oh.
Can I help you? High five. Do you want to just join us right now?
Oh.
Yeah. Go, let's get a chair. Can we get another mic for him, too? Yeah.
That'll work.
Okay. And you just keep talking. Pretend like I'm not here.
This is Austin Tindle, by the way.
Ladies and gentlemen, Austin Tindle.
Yeah. He's not just like some random guy from the audience.
This is Louis, the town drunk. He got in somehow.
The town drunk.
Miami had had an election.
Okay,
he's the town
really
drunk.
Sorry. I did not mean to interrupt.
No. The more the merrier. This is great.
You're in the conversation now.
You're in now, man. Get him a mic. Yeah, well, you're in it to win it.
I feel fancy now.
Oh, there you go.
Okay, I'm going to try really hard not to interrupt you. Please continue.
Do you have an opinion on the what they were talking about?
We're talking about female gaming?
Yeah.
Okay. I got paid to be in a show called... This is... Whatever. I'm going to... cameras. I got paid to be in a show... Whatever. I believe in this. I got paid to be in a show called Prison School. And in my opinion, it was... there's fan service, right? But this was a show about... characters that were technically portrayed as children and were over-sexualized to the nth degree. Mm. And there was a really small moment where the writer, who is a very good friend of mine, I won't name him by name, but you can look it up, obviously.
Obviously.
he decided to retranslate one line where there was a male character in the show who looked at a female character in a seductive way, and he retranslated her line in the original Japanese was something like, "You can't do that, I'm an upperclassman." Something like that that doesn't make
that
a lot of sense
very
to Americans.
Japanese, yeah.
And it didn't fit with the syllables, which is right. The main thing you have to deal with as a writer. So he translated it to, what, are you one of those Gamergate creeps?
Ooh.
And he almost lost his job.
Yeah.
Like, and not only did he almost lose his job, but there was a Twitter frenzy against the female lead writer who was not even responsible for doing that. It was, in my opinion, a disgusting display of an ignorant opinion, and it was so intense and emotional and personal from so many people, and they started attacking all these people that they don't know on Twitter because of this weird, like, I mean, I'm a cis hetero, sorry, but most of us are like, I don't know, it's like bad. There's this rampant misogyny that they somehow try to justify, and it scares me, and it's gross, and it's terrible.
Very scary.
And I was the lead of that show, and I got paid to do it, and I still think about that sometimes.
Yeah.
Hi, everybody. My name's Austin.
You know him better as Judas, apparently. No, not really.
Oops.
I'm not
God,
really.
This is
you don't have you didn't get paid in 30 pieces of silver, though, right? You're good on that.
It's okay. I've said worse things in front of cameras.
Oh, good.
Not worse things. Whatever. That's not worse. I believe that. Screw you people. You just go get a job.
They all believe you're
Stop
a good person.
Bugging people on the internet. Man, it got bad. Gamergate got bad. I didn't know what it was until I read it on the internet. I was like, this is terrible.
Yeah.
Someone needs to go to jail. You should go. Whoever you were, you should probably go to jail. You shouldn't do that to people. That's messed up.
Yes.
Staring right at you. Okay, sorry. Continue. I did not mean to interrupt everyone. You go. You guys go.
This
I'm done.
Gamergate. It's a terrible thing. What are your thoughts on Gamergate? Have you ever been the victim of like any kind of negative attacks, like on Twitter or social media, Twitch?
I will say, okay, there's this one time, and you know, I'm fairly new to people on the internet that I don't know knowing me. It's not something I'm used to. I was trained as a theater actor. I'm used to doing local theater. Right. Used to local people being like, oh, you did that thing. But I'm not used to, like, random people on the internet being like, hey. So there was an incident recently. This doesn't equate at all because I'm not a female and you guys got to deal with a bunch of stuff that I will never understand, and that's terrible. So in terms of Gamergate, there was something I had to educate myself on and go, wow, that is a terrible situation. That's so weird. But the closest analogy that I can have is that I got a Twitter imposter.
Yeah.
And I found out one morning, I was like, I have a Twitter imposter. And I was like, I got a Twitter imposter.
Did he have a
Some
mustache?
Some random, huh?
It was just you with a goatee, right?
No, what he did, okay. The thing is, the Twitter handles, they, if you look at just like the name and the handle, it doesn't know the difference between a capital I and a lowercase L.
Oh.
So this guy was at Austin Tindy. And he started sending creepy messages to all my female friends to the point where one of my female voice actor friends like texted me a screenshot and she said, did you send this to me? And I was like, wah, no. And I in a matter of hours, I went from being like really proud that I had an imposter to being so pissed off. Because this guy, first of all, okay, I'm a raunchy, terrible person, but if I'm going to be raunchy, it's going to be on purpose. It's not going to be some weird, cryptic stuff. And this kid I'm not gonna tell you the voice actress's name. Anyway, he tweeted this voice actress, right? A picture of a real life female sitting backwards in a chair. Just a picture. Imagine the picture of a girl sitting backwards in a chair, fully clothed. And then he tweeted to this person and he said, "This is how this person likes to sit in chairs." He did that on my behalf, and it's like, not only is that creepy, but it's just like really lame creepy.
Right. Yeah.
Anyway, authorities got involved, right. And some poor 13-year-old boy got in a lot of trouble from his parents. Sorry, dude. Anyway, that's the closest I can get, but I have a lot of female friends in the industry, and man, they deal with a lot of stuff that I can't even understand. So that's all. All
right.
Anybody else want to talk about it?
Well, I don't think Dan and I have anything. We're not really qualified.
I don't have an imposter. No, I don't have a doppelganger, not a woman right now. So yeah.
Sorry, guys. I'm in a really ranty mood right now.
Rant?
Not Randy, but ranty.
Oh, rants. Okay. Okay.
That changes the conversation.
That would be a creepy thing to say right. After that. I'm talking about that gets me going. Anyway, sorry. Shut up. Hey, how's it going? Hi, guys. How are you? How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How about yourself?
I'm doing awesome. How are you doing?
I'm fantastic. How about you?
Good, but I am poorly dressed compared to you. Let's go down the line and talk about how we're doing.
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. Yo. Yo. Krysti, what are you doing?
What are you doing?
I don't know, man.
I know. I can tell you don't know what you're doing.
Okay, I'll stop. I'll stop. You go.
Shh.
I'm gonna shut up.
Good night.
I'm done.
I'm not done. Like a falconer's hood. Just put like a hood over you so you go to sleep. Like putting a blanket over a birdcage.
Lullabies work better.
You know? Do we have a blanket we can just throw over his head?
Lullabies.
No, I don't think we have. We might be able to get one soon, but not in enough time for this show to end.
Soft melodies. We could keep this going all night.
Why not? No one else has a stage after this except for the DJ.
At least until 10.
Oh, yeah, no, there's a dance tonight. We can't stay forever. We could do the panel with the DJ in front, right? Yeah.
No one asked me to go with them.
Oh. I'm sorry.
Oh.
Yeah. Do you want to go to the dance?
Yeah.
Beat me to it.
I'm texting your wife.
Shit.
Okay. I'm going to redirect my focus to these ladies. What, for you, your YouTube, what is your, like, mission statement with that?
Geek and Gorgeous is all things geeky. I do cosplay tutorials, fashion segments, anything to do with sci-fi. I do a lot of interviews. I work with cons and go behind the scenes and interview all the different celebrities at shows. Do a lot of hosting. I used to host for the Walking Dead con as well. So a lot of stuff like that. Yeah. And doing cosplay full-time now.
Traveling. Oh, good. Yeah. What are some of your more popular cosplays?
So I have a series. It's a tutu series. So I started with the TARDIS. It's 26 yards of tulle, big puffy thing. And then
like a TARDIS.
Yes, tutu. And then my most popular one in the series is R2-2-2. R2-D2.
Gotcha.
R2-D2.
And I'll be wearing that one on Sunday.
Oh,
and then I just did a Darth Vader costume. I have a Harley Quinn in the series. And the newest
I think I've seen
one,
your Harley, yeah, it's
and
cute.
And the newest one is C-3PO.
Oh, my God. Good for you, because you know what? He does not get enough love.
No,
he
and
doesn't.
There's no tutu. So it's giant, and I'm really excited,
and gold.
Too. It's gold. Oh, it's sparkly.
Yes, I love gold.
Yeah. I was like, I just want to do something with sparkles. I just want to put sparkles and glitter and gold. Yeah.
And that's how you get an A on all your projects.
Yeah. It's just Karli and, like, 4 gallons of glitter puff paint. Just like, yeah. Dreams do come true.
I'm so happy. Yeah, that's what I'm working on.
Right what now. Are some cosplays you're known for?
I like trying to do cosplays that are a little bit not done that much. Like, I like doing, like, gender benders or, like, armored Charizard. Just something that, like, I can kind of use my imagination and kind of I don't have to look at what's already out there.
Especially when you are working with something that is already out there, people are very judgmental, and that's when we go into the hate with
absolutely.
Cosplay.
I was going to mention, like, I think as far as being a female gamer goes, female gamers are a lot safer than female cosplayers. Like, I see so much hate in the cosplay community, and people always ask me, like, do you cosplay? You should cosplay. And I'm like, no, because I'm terrified. People are so mean.
Don't be scared. Honestly, we'll protect you. Protect me.
There is a lot of hate with it, but I've been doing it for 4 years now full time, and I could count the amount of times that there's been bad comments or something. Like,
yeah.
If
I feel like not everyone is as lucky as you, though.
But if you just avoid it and you kind of, like, have a positive outlook with it, you don't attract it.
Aren't you guys from Canada?
We are. Maybe people just like us.
Oh, that's why there's no hate.
There we go. Everyone's a lot nicer there. So
that's it.
Mystery solved.
Everybody's too busy watching Trailer Park Boys. They don't do anything else.
Decent.
Yeah,
it's too cold to hate on people.
Exactly. Everyone's at Tim Hortons like, I love you.
Yeah.
Keep me
warm. How can you be mad when there's poutine? I mean, there's no reason to be mad at anything ever.
It's the best.
Poutine. Poutine.
Poutine.
Delicious.
Poutine.
It's so strange. You guys don't have Caesars either.
Mm-mm, no.
No.
Mm-mm. No. Sorry. We
don't
got
have Tim Hortons either. I think there's some in, like, Michigan or, like, the Ohio area.
Yeah, I'm in the northern region.
We got a Miami Subs. They'll get your order wrong under 5 minutes.
Yeah. Tim Hortons was bought out by an American company, and it's not that good anymore.
Are you serious? When did this happen?
Oh, 5 years ago? Yeah.
That's a tragedy.
It is.
Because I love Tim Hortons so much. Yeah. Well, sorry for your loss. And your YouTube channel, what do you have up now?
So it's Azzyland, and I'm doing a lot of gaming news, talking about video games, like things I'm passionate about. I eventually want to start doing Let's Plays, but not yet.
You definitely should. You'd be really good at that. Yeah, for sure.
Azzy and I did a video together before we came here.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I bet that's adorable.
It's five things that we hate about cosplay.
And what are they? Can you give us, like, the clip notes?
Give us a trailer. Give us three, two, five.
I was first. You were first.
Okay, I talked about traveling with cosplay because it's such a pain in the
Try
ass.
Try packing this.
Yeah, I was just going to... It almost took me two luggages, and I was, like, trying to stuff shirts into my gauntlets because I wanted real clothes for, like...
You should have bought more suitcases. I have three suitcases.
Real clothes. I'll just go eat dinner in Charizard.
You call yourself a cosplayer, yeah.
I have three suitcases because my R2-D2 costume, the tutu, is 26 years of tulle. It takes its own suitcase. Yep.
I would love to be the TSA agent on that
one.
We have
stories about that.
Oh yeah.
They gotta be. They're gonna be like, what?
This shit goes through, like, the X-ray machine. They're like, what?
Yeah. Well, if you have magnets or if you have, like, wired, she has, like,
my Azir is all soldered wires,
uh-huh.
LEDs, and they opened it up because they thought it was a bomb. Held up at the airport. Yeah. I'm like, it's just a costume.
I will go through with the claw, or I do an Ash Williams from Evil Dead, and I have a giant chainsaw that I bring.
Oh, perfect.
And they're like,
that probably looks amazing just going through, like.
There's a chainsaw. They're like, you guys are so funny again.
And I gotta take my shoes off, and you go through with a chainsaw.
I know.
I got stopped with a bottle of water.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Chainsaw, though. We're fine
with
that.
We get searched.
What are you doing bringing a bottle of water on the airport?
I get thirsty. I bought it at the airport.
Well, to be fair, you're like a 7-foot-tall bearded guy. They're from Canada. Like, what are they going to do?
Yeah, that always happens, by the way. Yeah.
You're so nice. Unless if they were wearing hockey gear, then we're screwed. They destroy all of us.
Hockey fan? Are you a hockey fan?
I'm not really.
Hockey.
I'm not
really
big on sports, to be honest.
Wow.
I mean,
it's there. You don't have to be. It's not like a requirement or anything.
There's other Canadians that
you don't get.
I spend too much time doing other things.
You don't get health care if you're not a hockey fan. You have to, like, proclaim. You have to declare your team before you get health care.
I'm deported from Canada. Deported.
You're not Canadian enough.
Yeah, deported from Canada to America, where people are mean.
Will you guys take me in?
Yeah, I'm.
You're white.
It depends on who you
are. Yeah. Unfortunately.
We'll get back to you in November.
I should have a disclaimer. I'm Syrian, so I can say that there. I can criticize.
Just commenting on the state of things.
This has been a very political show, actually. We've talked about environment. Yeah. We've talked about gender roles.
Uh-huh. Did you guys know that whale vomit is worth like $100,000? I'm not kidding. Whale vomit is
what's it called?
Really?
Yeah, it's worth hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Really? Wouldn't it just get diluted in the water?
That's why it's so hard to
form.
Get.
Yeah.
You got to get the whale to vomit outside of the water or in a bag.
Mm.
Just saying.
How do you follow up with that? I don't know. You're looking at me like...
I dare you to follow up with that. I'm sorry. I'm just saying, isn't that interesting? I read it on Reddit recently.
Oh,
anybody? Reddit
whale
fans?
Vomit.
Reddit
no.
on Reddit.
Who's
everything
buying
you read on Reddit is true.
What country is buying whale vomit, though? I want to know. Where's the highest importing of whale vomit?
And why would
I feel like it's easterly.
It's got to be some Indonesian guy just like whale vomit. That's the key.
That's nationalist.
Yeah. It is a little bit nationalist.
But seriously, whale vomit.
Yeah.
It's like a gold rush out there.
The great whale rush.
Just going to quit my job.
There be gold in them portals.
Does it have to be gold? Doesn't it depend on what they're eating?
Huh?
Does it have to be gold? Doesn't it depend on what they're eating? Like, what if they eat, like...
Well, I mean, I was referencing the gold rush and talking about it's, like, familiar to the whale
rush.
Right,
yeah, it's the new hot ticket. It
doesn't matter anyway. The gold standard's gone. Invest in bitcoins. Sorry, continue.
So other things you hate about cosplay.
What else do we hate? Oh, I said that I hated styling wigs. That's a big thing that I don't like about cosplay. I went to fashion school and to film school. I did not go to hairstyling school.
And synthetic hair is like much more difficult to style as well.
Yes. And then what else did you hate?
I hated uncomfortable costumes like this one. I can barely sit right now. I'm like, how are you existing? I'm like, I'm not.
Someone needs to invent cosplay hammocks for you guys. Just like easy in and out.
I like this idea very much.
All right, I'm on it.
Cosplay's not easy.
No.
There's no easy way in and out of cosplay. What was the last thing?
Hated drafting, and we both hated haters.
That's right. Haters is a big one. Drafting is another one.
Drafting?
Drafting.
Drafting. If you are doing something either with fabric or even with warbla, like you have to draft out the pattern first that's sized properly to your body type. So it's a lot of math, a lot of measuring, blah, blah, blah. Mm. Not good at that. She is.
I took mathematics and science in school, so drafting. I love drafting. So.
Yeah.
I can't count past 10, so that would probably be, like, really hard for me.
One.
I was an English major, so I was like, what major can I have where, like, has, like, the most minimal math?
Remember when you complained about wearing boots?
I'm actually an electrical engineering major.
Woo!
Do you ever take discrete mathematics?
No, I didn't. I took calculus, algebra, biochem.
I got to vector calculus before. I was like, never mind. That's all.
Hi, Nick.
Hi.
You're smart.
I'm a preschool teacher. I didn't go to college. I took a 2-week class. All right.
Did Karli say what she majored in? I feel like we need to tell. Everyone needs to say things now.
Television broadcasting.
Oh, television. You did
design.
Say. Right. Okay. What was you?
It was an English lit major.
English lit major. That's fantastic.
Yeah. I was like, I'm just going to go to school, read a lot of books.
Mm.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, very and nice. Here I am.
Yeah.
Did you say what was you?
What was you
what
to the English
you?
Lit
Clearly
major?
Clearly not an English
what was
major.
No.
No.
What
I is like books.
Oh, man. I talked to a person earlier, and she is so not here, but she's like a founder of a nonprofit that is all about creating benefits for women that are into computer science and coding. Ah, she's so not here, and I forgot to get her card. But anyway, there's a person here. Go find her.
There you go.
She's really
cool. You heard him.
So stay in school is what we're all trying to tell everyone. There you go. I'm happy with this. What are we doing? It's a nice little silence. We're all comfortable with each other. It's all right.
We could do like a musical chairs thing and have somebody take a chair out.
Can
each
we
time.
Do a musical chair?
I don't think
can we just
can
put on
that.
The
someone's gonna get knocked out.
I want a Broadway musical chair. Play Man of La Mancha and then we'll stop it at any point, please.
I was so joking.
you're not playing musical chairs. You're gonna take someone down. I actually have a question,
Lisa. How much time do we have left?
We're done.
All right, great. Okay then.
Azzy's so excited to go get out of that costume.
I'm gonna take it off now.
Yeah. She's gonna walk into the hotel. It's gonna explode off her. Maybe.
It wouldn't even make it to the hotel.
Maybe.
We never discuss who does the sign off. Do you want to sign off?
I didn't think we'd make it this far.
And that's the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for staying at Supercon tonight. Please stay. We've got some more fun stuff. This party doesn't stop till 2 o'clock in the morning tonight. I'm going to bed, but you guys stay.
I'm going to bed.
That was okay. You clapping and us going off stage, so I don't know.
All right.